Okay, thank you all for coming once again for this Bible study. We do this Bible study once a week on Sundays. We have been doing it recently at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, and I'm glad you guys are here once again. So, what's very unique about this Bible study that we do is we approach it from the Dead Sea Scrolls perspective. And there are a lot of people who aren't very familiar with what the Dead Sea Scrolls are or the importance that they have. And so I'm going to be explaining just a little bit at the beginning of this teaching about the Dead Sea Scrolls, because we have someone with us who has heard about the Dead Sea Scrolls but is wondering more about that and what the impact of the Dead Sea Scrolls are. So basically, the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered in 1948. That's when they first began to be discovered, and all the way to 1956, there were some more scrolls discovered in different caves. And these scrolls were very amazing because they were mostly in Hebrew. There were some scrolls in Aramaic, but they were copies of the Bible, or books of scripture, and these copies of Hebrew predated the oldest Hebrew copies by about 1,000 years. So before the Dead Sea Scrolls, the oldest Hebrew copies we had were about around 800 AD, about 800 years after the Messiah came. That's a long time between, and so pushing it back about 1,000 years gives us a much greater window towards the ancient world and enables us to better understand what the Bible was like in the time of the Messiah. What was the Bible that he used? And there's two major things about the Dead Sea Scrolls that when they were found is, one, the copies of the books that we have in our Bible, in the Dead Sea Scroll copies, there are many differences, and some of those differences are major, major differences. In other cases, there's not as many differences. So there's variance, extra words sometimes, or even extra like huge passages, or sometimes they're in different order. So the Dead Sea Scrolls reveal to us that there were copies of the Bible in ancient times which were very different from our copies. They had many extra passages which are not in our Bibles. They in a different order very often. And so that's something very important, because for those of us who accept the scriptures, we want to have the original word. What is his pure word? I can help you try to, John, I can try to help you set up Skype on another time this week sometime, maybe. It shouldn't be too hard to do. But so, the Dead Sea Scrolls show us a picture of, this is a version of the Bible that ancient Jews had, and that leads us to ask the question, are our copies of the Bible the closest to his original word, or are those Dead Sea Scroll copies the closest? And when you compare the Dead Sea Scroll copies to other copies in ancient times, like the early Christians, they all had their copies of the Bible from the Greek copies. The Greek copies were from the Septuagint, Greek translation of ancient Hebrew manuscripts. When you compare the Dead Sea Scrolls with those Septuagint copies of the early church, what you see is that the Dead Sea Scrolls very often have extra things and different order that agrees with the Greek copies and disagrees with our copies. So it suggests that the Septuagint is a very important tool and is a very ancient version, that is closer to the original version of the Bible than our copies are. So that's one of the biggest things of the Dead Sea Scrolls. That's very life-changing for the faith. And then the other thing is that there's other books that are part of the Bible in the Dead Sea Scrolls. In most people's Bibles, there's only a very few number of books in the Bibles. So the question becomes, what book should be part of the Bible? You mentioned earlier, you said that you're not part of any denomination, and you said that you just try to follow what the Bible says. And so the question is, though, nowhere in the Bible does it say, in our Bibles, does it say which books are part of the Bible. So that makes a difficult issue of, okay, well, what books should be in there then? Should we follow what men say, the church, and just reject most of these other books? Should we follow what the Jews do, reject the New Testament, reject the Messiah? Well, no, we believe in the Messiah, and are we going to follow the tradition of the church when they don't have any scriptural basis to support their position? I don't think we should do that. And so the Dead Sea Scrolls preserves a faith and a Bible of people who had a much bigger Bible and a much more ancient and purer version of the scriptures than we do. And the same thing with the Septuagint. Their version has a bigger Bible, more books in it, and is closer to the original than our copies. So that's what in these studies that we do, that I discuss from that perspective of the Dead Sea Scroll faith being closer to the original, having a fuller Bible that's purer. And I mean, you've got in the letter of Jude, Jude tells us that Enoch prophesied words, and the words that Jude quotes to us are the very words from the Book of Enoch. And the Dead Sea Scrolls, there were copies of the Book of Enoch found, and those very words that Jude quoted were found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. So it shows us that the Book of Enoch was written before Jude wrote his letter, which means that we have to conclude that Jude was quoting the Book of Enoch, and then he was quoting it as the very words of Enoch himself. And if that's the case, then who should we trust more? The church, who says Enoch is not written by Enoch? Or should we trust what Jude the Apostle tells us and accept Enoch as a true prophet? And that's the Dead Sea Scroll perspective of accepting Enoch. Jubilees, the Book of Jubilees was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And the Ethiopian church is a very important witness to the ancient faith of the apostles, because the Ethiopian church, they still keep the Sabbath. They're one of the only churches that keep the Sabbath still. And they also have the Book of Enoch as part of their Bible. They have the Book of Jubilees. And their Bible is much bigger than ours. So the Ethiopian church is an important witness to the Dead Sea Scroll faith. So that's what these studies are all about from the perspective of the Dead Sea Scroll. Now, I believe the Messiah was an Essene. When I say Essene, that means a ancient Jewish denomination. Like you've heard of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. I'm sure you've heard of those. But we never hear mention of the Essenes in the New Testament, and I believe there's a reason for that. Every time you see the Pharisees and Sadducees mentioned in the New Testament, it's always to criticize them, to condemn them, to rebuke them. You never see the Essenes there, and I believe the reason for that is he's not rebuking them, he's not condemning them, because he agreed with them on essentially everything they believed. Maybe there was a couple differences, but essentially he agreed with the Essenes. And how we know what the Essenes believed is Josephus describes he lived in the first century, and he told us some of the beliefs of the Essenes. When the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered, what we found was that the Dead Sea Scroll description, the ideas, the teachings of the Dead Sea Scrolls match so closely to what Josephus says about the Essenes, it makes for a very confident identification that the Dead Sea Scroll writers were Essenes. And the evidence to me from my studies is that these Dead Sea Scroll writers, the Essenes, that is, they had the original Bible, they had all of his word, and they interpreted scripture the correct way and in line with what the Messiah said against all the other Jews. The Pharisees were not interpreting it properly. And so I identify with the Essenes, the Dead Sea Scroll writers, as my faith, because I see the Messiah on the Dead Sea Scrolls. I see his teachings there. I see him full of life in the Dead Sea Scrolls, full of the Holy Spirit, and the teachings resonate so much with the Messiah's teachings. So that's why I, after seeing so many similarities of the same teachings, I concluded that they had the true faith, and I converted to their faith as best that I could back in 2011, and I've been teaching that faith ever since, through the perspective of the Messiah being the one who was prophesied of. The Dead Sea Scrolls were written before the Messiah came, so they were looking forward to the Messiah, and now we look back to when he came, and so that gives a slight different perspective, because the Dead Sea Scroll writers did not have the privilege of the New Testament to help them understand the truth, whereas we have that. But with the New Testament, I believe when you compare the teachings of the New Testament with the Dead Sea Scrolls, you see that the New Testament writers were in that, they came out of that group. They came out of the Dead Sea Scroll group. So the Dead Sea Scroll faith is our foundation. And then we advance to the ultimate fulfillment of that faith, and that ultimate fulfillment is our Messiah. So he fulfilled the faith of the Dead Sea Scrolls, and so he's our focus. He's a teacher of righteousness for us. But the Dead Sea Scrolls is essentially, that's our Old Testament, and how we, that's what we use as the foundation before we come to the Messiah, and then we, as believers of the Messiah, we continue to use the Old Covenant, but in light of his atoning work that he did for us. So that's a bit of a description of the importance of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Hopefully that helps convey the basic idea that we do every week of, that's what we approach various issues of the Bible, focused on any topic that people are interested in, and you can ask any questions, and then I will share my thoughts based from that perspective. And it's not to tell you that you have to believe this, it'll just be me saying from the perspective of the Dead Sea Scroll faith, which I have attempted to convert to, this is what they believe, this is what I believe, and now I leave it to you, as seeker of truth, to judge what the Dead Sea Scrolls say, what their perspective on these different issues say, and you have to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, as the New Testament says. So that's what this is all about, giving you more information so that you can be better informed and make a better decision about what path to follow for the faith. And we ask questions. We have people ask questions, but in recent weeks, we haven't been doing as many questions because a lot of people just haven't really been asking these questions. They don't really have anything on their mind to ask. And so what I've done on previous weeks, when people didn't really have any questions, I would just start teaching just whatever came to my mind on a different topic. And often what I would do is go through a scripture and point out to them various differences in the older copies compared to our copies, showing that our copies are missing a lot. That's what I've done in some of these studies. But so, do you guys here, we only have three people here right now, do you guys have any questions on your mind? And if you don't, then I'll just try to share with you all whatever comes to my heart. I try to keep this not scripted. I don't like to do scripted teaching because it enables... I think it can be much more interesting when you leave open to what is going to be discussed. We can approach any topic, so that's really cool to have that openness and flexibility. So do you guys have any questions at the moment? I'll wait for a minute to see if anyone does. I'm just going to see if one other person said they were coming. I'm going to see if she plans on coming. One second here. Let's see here. Okay, so this time I might just start teaching like I've done the other time. One second while I message Barbara. Okay, so let's see here. I think I'm not gonna do a study this time through the scriptures, in the sense of like what I've done before is I've gone through different verses and showed you or showed the people huge differences. Those are really cool studies, but I'm gonna do that on another time. But this time I'm just gonna do more of an introduction to the what was in the Dead Sea Scrolls. So let's see here. You know, I've been working on something. I've been working on a write-up on a website that I have. It's not fully finished yet, but a good chunk of it is finished. I'm going to go through that. And so basically I'll be reading from that, from what I've written. And then I'm going to, on different parts that I'll stop and then kind of explain. And as I'm reading, you can ask questions like, wait, where did you get that? Or how do you know that's true? Where are you getting some of this information? You can ask that at any time. And I will answer that for you. So, now, some of the stuff that I will be saying is based on my interpretation, but a good chunk of it is not. The vast majority of it is not my interpretation, but it's actually what these Dead Sea Scrolls are saying. And so you will find it very compelling information, but if you're skeptical about anything or you're not sure about what I'm saying, please by all means ask, and I will clarify and provide evidence for things I say. So basically, using the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Book of Jubilees, we find out that there are differences in the dating of when creation was, when Adam was made. Using our copies of the Bible, the people's regular copies that most people use, you can date using the genealogies. Like it says in Genesis, Adam was this number of years old, and then he had a son, and his son was this number of years old, and then he had a son, and it goes like that through each line. But in different copies, like in the Septuagint, the numbers are very different. In the Samaritan copies, the numbers are very different. And in the Book of Jubilees, the numbers are very different. So it makes it difficult for people trying to figure out what the correct reading is. When was creation? When was Adam made? And from the studies that I've done, from the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Book of Jubilees was the key text that preserved the correct dating method, and it agrees closest with the Samaritan copies of Genesis, the dating of the Samaritan the genealogy. So in other words, our copies of the genealogy, there are so many differences between the different copies of Book of Genesis, and these copies are clearly intentional. Like, for example, in the Hebrew copies of the Jews, the regular Jews, they say Adam was 105 years old, and then 130 years old when he had his son, and then he lived 800 years more and died when he was 930. But what does the Septuagint say? The Septuagint says he was 230 years old when he had his son, and he lived 700 more years and died when he was 930. So right there, you see, in one version, it says 100 plus 830 equals, 130 plus 800 is 930. But in the Greek copies, it is 230 plus 700. So there, it's 100 extra on the one side and 100 less on the other. So that shows that they're doing math. It was not a scribal error, but the difference in the numbers was intentional, because the people were studying perhaps other cultures, history, trying to reconcile it with other evidence, and so they would change. They changed the numbers in the genealogies of how old they were to make it so that the creation would be earlier, so that it could reconcile with the other nation's history. So there's a lot of differences in these copies, but the Dead Sea Scrolls presents to us the purest version of the genealogy, the oldest, the most original version, and that makes it so that we can pinpoint when the creation was, when Adam was made. And so I'm going to be using the Dead Sea Scroll dating method when I go through this write-up that I made. I'm going to be using that dating method. So just that was just to give you a clarifier for that. So now I'm beginning from my website write-up that I did. In 3835 BC, Adam, the first human, was created by God. When Adam was created, Satan rebelled against God. And Adam was taught by God the religion of nature. Now, I'll stop there for a second. What do I mean by the religion of nature? Because people might hear that term and they might associate that with paganism. But that's not the case. Basically, in the original faith, they didn't have a name. Just like you were saying, I don't identify with any denomination. But it was just the faith. It was righteousness. And what was righteousness? You know, the Messiah told us what righteousness was. That was loving your neighbor as yourself, and loving God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and doing unto others what you had them do unto you. Basically, it's the law of nature. It's respecting people and loving people. That's harmony. So that's essentially what I mean when I say nature. It's when we sin, we are going against our natures, because our natures are to be righteous and to be good people. So Adam was taught by God the religion, the true religion of nature. And in 3828 BC, Satan caused Adam to sin, and this resulted in the corruption and defilement of the entire earth and all life. Now, where do I get that date, 3828 BC? According to the Book of Jubilees, which again was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and that is why we accept, that's one of the reasons why we accept that book as scripture, but there are many other reasons as well. But so in Jubilees, we're told that Adam was in the garden for 7 full years. And then in the 7th year, Adam sinned and partook of the fruit of the garden of Eden. Now, in our copies of the Bible, it does not tell us exact details of like how long they were in the garden, how long it took them to leave, but there's something very interesting in Jubilees. What we're told in Jubilees is that Adam sinned, but guess what? According to Jubilees, they didn't leave the garden right after he sinned. They were in there for about a month and a half after he sinned. They were still in there for about a month and a half, and then they got kicked out. So that's an interesting thing, that basically he was still giving them time to be in the Garden of Eden a little bit, but then he came to the conclusion that, okay, Adam has to leave, because if he keeps staying here, then he's going to keep eating from the tree of life, and every time you eat from the tree of life, it heals you of wounds you have. So when you ate from the tree of life, it did not make it so that you live forever and never die. What it did was, it was sort of like the, similar to the Fountain of Youth thing, is that I've seen it depicted in other shows, or where when people went to the Fountain of Life, they would make themselves younger, but then if they didn't partake of it again, they had to go back, otherwise they would get old. So that's what the same is for the Tree of Life. When you partook of the Tree of Life, it didn't make you invincible and invulnerable to death forever. It basically healed you and returned you to a state of purity and perfect health. But if you didn't eat from the Tree of Life after that, you would continue to age and eventually would die. So that's why, according to Jubilees, when they took from the forbidden fruit, they weren't kicked out immediately, because it wasn't the end of the world if they had eaten the Tree of Life a couple times after that. They were in the garden for 7 years, Jubilees said, so they probably ate from the Tree of Life many times before that. But once they started eating it, they were eating it too much, and that is the reason, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, why they had to leave the garden, because they were using the Tree of Life too much, and it was extending their life longer than what they deserved, so they were kicked out. So then, in 3737 BC, Cain, at the instigation of Satan, murdered Abel. So basically, it was about 100 years after creation, or after Adam was made. According to Jubilees, we get that date. It was about 100 years after. And then Jubilees tells us that after Cain killed his brother, Abel, he fled away, and Adam and Eve were so upset that they were in mourning for about 28 years, and they were not sleeping together, or not being intimate with each other for 28 years, because they were just so grief-stricken over the loss of their child. But then, after the 28 years, they began to get joyful, Jubilee says, and they decided to love each other once again. And Adam had a son named Seth. And so we see, of course, this is agreeing with Genesis, the various details. It's corresponding. Jubilees is supplementing the account of what Genesis tells us. Sorry for if there's noise in the background. So if you can hear it, my apologies. Seth, when he was born, he had a family of his own, and his children were very righteous. He had a righteous line, whereas for Cain, Cain's line was one of sin and wickedness. And so you had the line of Seth and the line of Cain. Sons of Seth and sons of Cain. Now I'll stop there for a second. There was a teaching that some people had later on that the giants, or the Nephilim that Genesis mentioned, came from the sons of Seth mixing with the sons of the daughters of Cain. But that's not the case. That's an incorrect understanding, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls. books. However, it is true that there were a Sons of Seth and a Sons of Cain line, and they were at odds with each other. And so it's kind of like there's some truth to what those people are saying, but they twist it to suggest that the Nephilim were just humans. And that's not the case according to the Dead Sea Scroll faith and their scriptures. Like, for instance, in the Book of Enoch, which, as I said earlier, Jude quotes and proves to us that it's scripture and truly by Enoch. Enoch tells us that it was angels. Angels came down, and angels were the one who sinned against God and slept with humans and created, they had children by them, and those children were the Nephilim. That's what Genesis chapter 6, verse 4 tells us. It was the sons of God came down to the daughters of men. And from this time, there was a lot of corruption and wickedness in the world due to this sin that they committed. Now, hold on one second. Okay. However, when the angels first came down, they did not come down to sin at the beginning. There's a misconception a lot of people have who study the Book of Enoch. They think that the angels descended immediately for the sole purpose of sinning and having children with these women. But that's not what the Dead Sea Scroll writings tell us. They tell us a fuller story. Basically, around 3375 BC, the Watchers descended. Why? In order to teach all the sons of men righteousness and wisdom, and they taught the people the true religion. So they came down because they saw all the wickedness that the sons of Cain were doing and other people on earth. There were, you know, it wasn't just the sons of Cain, but the sons of Cain were the most wicked. And so the Watchers, they were called the Watchers. These were a special angels, group of angels that were called the Watchers. The Watchers, that order is mentioned in the Book of Daniel. Daniel mentions that he saw a Watcher. So this concept is biblical, and it's in the Book of Enoch where we see the Watchers as well. But so Jubilees tells us that the Watchers descended at this time to teach humanity what righteousness and wisdom was, and to basically purify the people because they were in so much sin and wickedness. So that is why they first came down. Around 3242 BC, Enoch was chosen by the Watchers to be initiated fully into the secrets of the Watchers in order that he might be the chief teacher of all mankind of righteousness and wisdom. And he was chosen because he was an extremely righteous man, and he was the only man in his time who never sinned in his entire life. I'll stop there for a second. That teaching that there are some humans who have never sinned in their entire life, a lot of people believe that that doesn't jive with what the Bible says. Hold on one second, sorry. Sorry about that. There's a lot of people who think that we were born with a sin nature and that we have original sin and that everyone has to sin. If we don't believe that, then we're sinning because we are daring to say that we have the ability to be sinless. But you have to remember that we are told in the scriptures in Genesis that God created us. God created all of creation, and how did He create it? He created it good. If we had a nature where we had to sin, or we had a sin nature or original sin that made us all sinners by nature, against our ability to change it, we have no ability to be sinless, then how was the creation really good if He created us with a sinful nature? And how could mere men create us, create our natures to be sinful? The book of Ezekiel chapter 18, it tells us that a man shall not die for the sins of his father. And when you read Ezekiel 18, it really sounds can you guys hear me? I got knocked out, it seems. Sorry about that. If it happens again, just be patient and I'll log right back in. I don't know why that happened. So, basically, Ezekiel 18, when you study that, if you look and compare that to what people say about Adam, it's so similar. It really sounds like Ezekiel is rebuking the original sin teaching that people say about Adam and Eve. If you read it, it says, the people are set on edge because of what the fathers ate. They ate, like, with their teeth, they ate grapes. And so it makes it sound like the Israelites were telling people, teaching them that people are guilty for the sins of others. And that's what original sin teaches, that we're sinners, we have original sin, we deserve damnation solely because Adam made us to be sinners by his sin. That's not the case, according to the Dead Sea Scroll perspective. But what Adam did do, he did do something major. And what he did is similar to, if you imagine this, if you have an abusive father who's a drunkard, if you grow up in an environment like that, that's a very negative environment. It's constant negativity being thrown at you. You are much more likely to be a horrible person in imitation of your father if you're subjected to that from an early time. Just because of we get influenced by people. And so influence, however, is not forced. So you're not forced to sin, but you can be strongly influenced into sin. And that's what happened. Because Adam sinned, he created an extremely strong influence in the world that made it so that almost everyone was going to sin because it was so hard to not sin. But it's not impossible to sin. And there were, according to the scriptures, there were some men who never sinned. One of those being the Messiah himself. He was fully man. He was also divine, but he was a complete man just like us. He did not have a special, basically, in order for him to atone for us, he had to be a true man. If we as humans had a sin nature, then how could he be a true man if he didn't have a sin nature? If having a sin nature is part of the human condition, then he would need to have a sin nature in order to be a true human. But since the fact is we don't have a sin nature, he was every much a human as we were. There was no difference. The humanity of us was the same as his humanity, but he just had, his spirit was of the divine spirit. So that's why I say Enoch was the only one in his time who had never sinned, because the scriptures indicate that. And so because he had never sinned, the watchers blessed him, and they took him and they brought him with them, and they taught him many secrets. And Enoch wrote down these secrets in many books. There's the Book of Enoch. There was also another scroll found, which is called the Book of Giants. And there was the Book of Lamech, which all had extra books of Enoch in those things. And there's even another one called Second Enoch. That's not as reliably preserved. It's the copies of it are a little corrupted. But it's still, there's a lot of things about that book which seem very authentic and part of the true faith. And so there's all these different writings of Enoch, which shows that Enoch had was revealed a lot of mysteries and truths of the Watchers, the heavenly secrets. And so around 3183 BC, 200 of the Watchers, so the Watchers that came down to teach righteousness, 200 of those decided to sin and sleep with daughters of men, the sons of Cain. But did they come down and victimize the... Did they seek out these women? according to the Dead Sea Scroll books, they didn't seek out the woman. The woman sought them out, because the woman, when they saw these watchers, they saw how glorious they looked, how beautiful and attractive they were, and they knew that they were watchers. They knew that they were heavenly beings. And in there, it's kind of like, you know how people have celebrity crushes, and they're like, they're so, like, intense in their attraction to these crushes, and they these celebrities, and they treat them as if they were gods, or if they were, you know, stars, their idols. It was a very similar thing in that time. They treated these watchers as their idols. They knew that they were stars and amazing, and they wanted to be with them. And the watchers, they had changed their form into man, to flesh, so that they could live among us and appear to us. In the Bible, we see that happen too. We see angels appear as men and communicate with Abraham and others. And in the New Testament, we're told you might have angels coming to you unaware. You might not be aware that they come to you. These angels, these watchers, when they were humans, they experienced the temptations of the flesh because they had transformed into a human form. And when they experienced those temptations, they gave in and slept with those women. And when they did that, they fell from their heavenly nature and became Nephilim. They became fallen ones, and they were not able to return to their immortal full glory, but they were forced to be a mortal, but they were a very powerful mortal, and they still had the ability to change their form, and they still had a lot of their angel powers, but they did not have the full glory that they once had, their immortal nature. They lost it because of their sin. That's what these writings tell us. And then, their children were also Nephilim, fallen ones. Their children had, they were part human and part angel. And as a human, they were limited to much more. But as having angel blood in them, or angel DNA, they had a lot of abilities that angels have, which humans don't have. So they were in between, and they were also called Nephilim. All these Nephilim, their children that they conceived, they were giants. They became giants, and they grew very tall, and according to these scriptures, and Genesis tells us that they were giants as well. And so these Nephilim corrupted and defiled the earth and all life in it. They did it so much that they did it more than Adam did. When Adam corrupted the earth, he corrupted it, yes, but nothing like what the Watchers corrupted it, because the Adam did not make it so that, you know, a flood had to come to kill everybody because they were so wicked. But when the Watchers came, they corrupted things so much that everyone started murdering people, eating each other, cannibalism, horrible sexual sin, all kinds of horrible sin because of these Watchers. So compared to Adam, Adam hardly corrupted the world. The angels were the one who really corrupted it so much worse, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls. There's a strong angel understanding of demonology. You know, there's demons in the New Testament. There's not demons in most people's copies of the Old Testament. Where did the demons come from? In the Dead Sea Scrolls, we're told where they came from. Enoch, the Book of Enoch tells us, the Book of Jubilees tells us, the Book of Noah. All these books that were found in the Dead Sea Scrolls tell us the origin of demons. So there's a strong angel focus in the Dead Sea Scrolls, which is also in the New Testament, but which is not in the regular Bible of the Old Testament. So that's an important connection. Let's see here. Now, in 2948 BC, Enoch's initiation into the heavenly secrets by the righteous watchers was completed. This was over a period of six jubilees. So when Enoch was 365 years old, this is when his initiation into all the secrets that the Watchers wanted to teach him, that was when it was finished. And because of that, right after that, Enoch was transformed into a heavenly being, and he was placed in paradise. Now, what does it mean to be transformed into a heavenly being? It does not mean he was made into an angel, but rather, basically, Genesis tells us that Enoch never died. It says, for everyone else in the genealogy, it says, and this man lived this number of years, and then he died. This man lived this number of years, and then he died. But for Enoch, it says, he lived this number of years, and then, because he walked with God, he was taken, and he was no longer on the earth. But it does not say that he died. And that's clearly intentional. If he had died, it would have told us that. And there's other writings which tell us that Enoch, like Jubilees, says that Enoch was placed in the Garden of Eden, or paradise, after he was taken. So he didn't die. The Book of Enoch tells us that Enoch was still alive when he was 500 years old. Genesis tells us that he was taken when he was 365 years old. So when Enoch was still 500, he was still there, according to the Book of Enoch. So how is that possible? He was made immortal. He was made so that he's still a human, but he was made so that he does not die. And he has access to the Tree of Life. The Messiah, he rose from the dead into a literal body, and he's still here. He's still alive. How is that possible? Because he was transformed into an immortal being. But he's still a human. So just Enoch was the same. Enoch was transformed into a heavenly being according to these Dead Sea Scroll writings. Now, Enoch delivered to his son Methuselah, and he also delivered to Noah, many of his writings. And he introduced them to his special, his faith that he had. And Enoch reformed the faith so much because the Watchers revealed so many secrets to him. And Enoch then, being a teacher for us, he revealed so many of these secrets to us. And this made such a huge reformation of the faith that it changed the faith a lot, because he instituted new commandments according to Jubilees. He gave us new commandments. He gave us a completely new paradigm shift and understanding of the world we live in. And so all of these writings Noah compiled, and he also compiled the writings of his forefathers. So Enoch was not the only one who wrote writings. We found in the Dead Sea Scrolls a writing from Lamech. Lamech was the father of Noah. And we also found writing, not in the Dead Sea Scrolls, but there's other writings like the writings of Adam. And so these writings were compiled by Noah, and he compiled them and wrote them on tablets. Put them on tablets, and he brought the tablets with him on the ark. Now God decided to send a swift judgment on the inhabitants of the earth and to purify it from sin and uncleanness. And so God sent his four chief angels, or archangels. They were Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, and Sariel. Michael and Gabriel are mentioned in our Bibles. Raphael is mentioned in the Catholic Bible in the Book of Tobit. He's also mentioned in the Book of Enoch. Sariel, or Uriel, he's mentioned in some of the Apocrypha as well. And he's also mentioned in the Book of Enoch. And so, but these scriptures tell us that these four angels were a special group of angels, chief angels, that did many things for God. And at this time, we are told that they caused the destruction of most of the Nephilim, and they bound all of the fallen watchers into a prison made specifically for them. That's why in the New Testament, we're told that the angels, when they left their bounds, they were imprisoned into Tartarus. That's what the New Testament says in, I think it's 2 Peter. It's the same story that Peter is deriving from these writings. Now, in 2528 BC, that was when God sent a flood to kill all flesh on earth. with the exception of Noah and his immediate family and a few animals, all of whom he spared. God spared all of them. And Noah alone was chosen. Why was he chosen? Because he was an extremely righteous man, and he was the only man in his time who never sinned in his entire lifetime. According to the Book of Noah that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, he was a righteous man. And when he was young, he observed the sin that was going on, and he chose to reject sin. And he became a pure man, a perfect man. Genesis tells us that he was a perfect man. All the other people in his generation, they were not perfect. But he was, Genesis tells us, he was perfect in his generation. And Jubilees tells us that he was the most righteous man except Enoch. Enoch only was more righteous than Noah, according to Jubilees. So, after the flood came, all flesh died that was living on land, including the Nephilim. But most of the Nephilim who were on the earth and died, because they were descended from heavenly beings, from angels, they didn't get sent to Sheol, you know, the place of the dead, Sheol, where most people, when they die, they go to Sheol, the place of the dead, to await the resurrection. But the Nephilim, that didn't happen to them, according to these books. What happened to them is they remained on the earth after they died. And then we are told that an angel from God appeared to the dead spirits of these beings, these Nephilim, and explained to them that the law that God was giving them. And God appointed Satan as a prince over all the spirits of the Nephilim. And the spirits of the Nephilim became demons. So I'll stop there for a second. That's a controversial statement. The basic idea is that God appointed Satan as someone to perform certain things of his will. But there is some evidence that this is the case. For instance, in the New Testament, we see there's demons. Well, we have to ask a question. Why would God allow the demons to be here? Why wouldn't he send them away? Why wouldn't he send them into prison like he did with the angels? Why didn't he do that? The reason is because there's a purpose for them. He has a purpose for them, and he uses them to punish sinners. That's what the Jubilees and the Dead Sea Scrolls teach us. It basically, we see many examples of where God uses sinners to perform righteous work. He used Nebuchadnezzar to punish Israel. He sent Nebuchadnezzar to capture the Israelites and to destroy their temple as a punishment for what they did. He sent many Gentiles to do different things for him. Cyrus was a pagan, but he chose Cyrus to help the Israelites build the temple once again, rebuild the temple. That's in the book of Ezra and Nehemiah. And so, just like that, he used these, according to these writings, he used the angels and the demons to perform his will and to punish evildoers with what they deserve. The demons, however, some of them go beyond what they are allowed to do, and they sin, and they're going to be punished for that in the end days. And so that's how there were demons according to these writings. After the flood was over, God made a covenant with Noah and all life on earth. Noah then, after that, officiated over the assigning of land as inheritance to his sons and to their sons. And Noah, he also introduced many new commandments, new ideas, new prophecies, and he reformed their faith majorly. And Noah then, he wrote tablets recording the in 2176 BC, in the year he died, he wrote tablets recording the events of his own life. And when he finished writing those tablets, he handed the tablets over to his firstborn Shem, and all the tablets of his forefathers, Enoch, Lamech, all the others, he gave all those tablets to Shem, and then Noah died. after that, according to the Dead Sea Scroll writings, after that, around 2147 BC, mankind was dispersed throughout the world, and God created from the language of creation many languages, and the various nations originated at that at this time. So in other words, the Tower of Babel story. That's when that happened. And then after Noah died, the religion that Noah had been teaching his sons, it broke off into many heretical denominations. Each were focusing on worshiping other gods in addition to the one true God. They were worshiping all these other gods and demons. They were worshiping demons. And so idolatry and polytheism flourished throughout the world, with only a few righteous men left. All of this had been instigated by the demons leading astray mankind. Around this time, Canaan, Ham's son, invaded the land that had been assigned to Shem's family and illegally stole the land for himself. So basically, according to Jubilees and the Book of Noah that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, Noah divided all the land as an inheritance to his children and to their children. And they made an oath that if anyone violated that, they deserved to be destroyed in war. And Canaan, later on, he did that. He stole the land that was given to Shem. He stole it for himself. And his children lived there. And that's why the land was called the Land of Canaan, the Promised Land. That's why it was called the Land of Canaan. And they were supposed to wipe out the Canaanites as punishment for violating the oath. So, Anne has joined us. Let me just tell you what I'm doing is going through... I did a write-up, which basically tells the overall history of the Dead Sea Scroll religion based on their writings, their scriptures. And I'm going through that and sharing with you all what they believed from what we can glean from their writings. This is what they believed, and this is... their understanding, and this is also my understanding, of the history of our faith and of the Bible. So at that time, every god had their own high priest. The Most High God, Yahuwah, or, you know, different people pronounce it, they pronounce it differently, but so Yahweh, or Yahuwah, he was the Most High God. He also had a high priest during this time, and his name was Melchizedek. So remember, each god had their own high priest, and the Most High God also had a high priest, and that was Melchizedek. And that's the importance of Melchizedek, because a lot of people don't understand, you know, like, there's not a lot of information about Melchizedek in the Bible, but that's the importance of him. He was the chief high priest for the Most High God, and that was an acknowledged status amongst the pagan world, because the pagans they did not reject the Most High God. They usually would acknowledge him amongst the other gods. That's what we see happening with Nebuchadnezzar. He speaks of his own gods, but then he also acknowledges that the Most High is the true God. And Pharaoh, the Egyptian Pharaoh in Genesis, we see the same thing happen. And in Exodus too, they acknowledge he is the Most High, and so they considered Melchizedek an authentic high priest of that God, and they accepted his authority for that particular God, and then they would go to the other gods, and to the other high priests, to do the worship in other ways as well. So in 1884 BC. God appeared to a man named Abram. Abram had been an extremely righteous man. He was the only man in his life who had never sinned in his entire lifetime. Earlier in this study, I gave evidence of the idea that certain men could be sinless. So for those who are questioning that idea, if you listen to this just being recorded, and if you listen to what I said earlier, that'll hopefully give you that understanding of the idea of certain humans, a select few of them, being sinless. But so Abram was a very righteous man. According to Jubilees, he was pretty much the only one in his time who rejected idolatry from his youth. He was 14 years old, and he decided to not live with his father anymore, Terah. He said, I can't live with Terah anymore, because if I live with him, I'm going to have to tolerate all this horrible sin, and I don't want to be anywhere near that. So he left his father to get away from the idolatry when he was only 14 years old. He was a very righteous man from his youth. And then, because he was so righteous, God appeared to him and chose him to restore Noah's religion. Because after Noah died, everyone was no longer following Noah's laws in accordance with the faith. They were falling away and sinning. So now Noah, he visited his forefather Eber. He was still alive, and he took from Eber all the tablets that Noah had given to Shem, and because Shem had given the tablets to Eber. And Jubilees tells us that an angel appeared to Noah in this year and taught him the language of creation. Noah was taught the language of creation. And Abram called it a Hebrew. The language was called Hebrew in honor of his forefather Eber, because he received the writings, the tablets, from Eber. And the language of those writings was revealed to him, and so he named it Hebrew in honor of them. Just like when Adam was naming the animals, he would name it based on their character and traits. And that's what Noah did for this language. Now, the angel helped Abram study the tablets of his forefathers. And during 6 months, we are told, the angel explained to him the meaning of all the tablets that had been written by the forefathers, Enoch, Noah, all those tablets. He explained the meaning to Abram. And Abram made copies of the tablets on new tablets, and he wrote down all the words of the angel on other tablets as well. Abram was commanded by God to leave his homeland and go to the land that belonged to him and his forefathers by right. Because remember, the land had been appointed by Noah, and it already belonged to Abram's family. And so he was told to leave his homeland and go to the land that was his by right. And so Abraham tried to teach his relatives the true religion of Noah, and he tried to bring his relatives with him, Terah, Nahor. He tried to bring them all with him, but his relatives were not willing to go with him yet. They weren't ready, and for this reason they were separated. Jubilees tells us his father spoke to him and said, you go there, and when you see the land there, you come back to me and bring me with you. You go there first, and then when you're all settled there, come back and take me with you. So, and we are also told that Terah realized that idolatry was not valid, and he wanted to come away from that. And so Abram decided to destroy the house of idols, Jubilee says. And this was done in order to free his father Terah from the bondage he was in. So many people are in bondage because they know sins are wrong, but they feel trapped and they keep doing those sins because they don't know what else to do. And they're afraid of what would happen if they don't do it. But Abram wanted to save his father, and he destroyed the idols and then taught his father his faith, and his father was receptive of the faith. But he wasn't coming with him, but he let Lot. Lot was his family, Abram's family, and Lot went with him. And so Abram separated, and afterwards God made a covenant with Abram, and Isaac was born to him. And then Abram's name was changed to Abraham, and the covenant of circumcision began. And during his lifetime, Abraham did many, he introduced many new laws, many new ideas and concepts. Remember, he restored the scriptures, the tablets. He received new prophecies, and so Abraham did many reformations, and he changed the faith significantly. So then, in 1784 BC, that was the year that Abraham died, he took tablets and he recorded the events of his own life. When he finished them, he handed over to Isaac his tablets, as well as all the tablets of his forefathers. I'll stop there for a second. So I said that Noah made tablets and Abraham made tablets. What's amazing is in the Dead Sea Scrolls, this is the case. We find that we found scrolls, copies in scrolls, albeit they were fragmentary, but they were copies of these books that Noah and Abraham had written. And there's so much amazing stuff in these books. If these were written by these men, and I fully believe they were, Jubilees says they were, so, and I trust Jubilees as scripture, these books were written by them, and this means that they're the foundation of Genesis. So how was Genesis written? Moses used these other writings that the patriarchs wrote to write Genesis. And so these writings are much older, more ancient, and they're the foundation of our faith. And they were found partially preserved in the Dead Sea Scrolls. So this is an amazing window of opportunity for us to go back to the ancient ways and go back to the beginning of what the original Bible truly was. Now there's a question. And again, as I said, at any time, if you have a question, you can ask, and I will take a pause and address this question. So Melissa asks about idols. Doesn't scripture also include likenesses, such as pictures, as idols? Well, you know, there's people who debate about that, and the answer to that would be based on, you know, we have to study what the Hebrew word of that means, and I'm convinced that that's not the case, and here's why. Because, for instance, in it seems like the law of Moses tells us that we were commanded to make the Ark of the Covenant, and what did we put on the Ark? We were told we have to carve image of the cherubim, the angels, the cherubim, and then we were told that Moses was commanded by God to make a bronze serpent that everyone was to look to, and they were, if they looked at it and repented, then they would be saved. So there's things like that. Solomon made special pictures and statues and put them in the temple. And also Ezekiel, in the book of Ezekiel, we're told that he was commanded to have like palm trees and other stuff like written on the various parts of the temple. So it seems to me that it's not talking about like an absolute prohibition of not making likenesses, but rather it's making images for the purpose of worshiping them. But if you wanted to take it to an extreme, because you can always go to the extreme, and for idols, like idolatry, if you say we can't make any image or things like that, well, we got a problem, because right now, you see the screen right here is an image, and it's making an image, and then there's the computer screen that you guys are looking at. There's a lot of stuff that, if you want to take it very literally to that extent in that interpretation, you could pretty much have to say, okay, you can't use any technology that has electronics. And as I said, because the scriptures speak of various instances, like of the Ark of the Covenant, with the cherubim being images of the cherubim, and the images in the temple, that tells me that it was not an absolute prohibition of all images, but it was a prohibition of images that were to be used for wicked purposes. Yes, these things are commanded by God. So the idea is God wouldn't command us to do something sinful. And so now there's the idea of, should we have a statue of me? I think that would be wrong. I don't know if I would call that idolatry. I don't want someone to make a statue of me. That's like putting me a little bit too high. I'm not that important to have a statue like that. And so the issue is what's the purpose of these images? You know, how do I put it? I don't know. It's just that's my thought, my take on it. What your purpose is for these images is really what makes it wrong or right. And the issue of the idolatry, if we go to the Hebrew, I think I've looked at it before. I'd have to look at it again. But when I remember going through it before, it seemed to me from the time I was studying it in the Hebrew that it was not an absolute of not making any images. So I guess to figure that issue, we'd have to go word by word through the Hebrew text to show you guys, to convince you whether it's okay or not. But it seems to me that because there's other instances that it has been done by the righteous and even by command of God, that it's not an absolute prohibition. But it's something we can revisit that issue in the future if people are still convicted about that. But again, as I said, to be consistent, we have to be consistent. And so we wouldn't be able to do a lot of things if we couldn't make any images at all. Like no pictures. You couldn't take pictures of people or videos. So no YouTube videos, none of that stuff. So I guess we want to be careful of going too far, and we don't want to be overly extreme, because there's a danger of being too extreme, but there's also a danger of being not extreme enough. So there's that balance we have to find. There's pictures of the Messiah, and what people do is very often they treat those pictures as if they were him himself. They treat them as magic and stuff like that. So that's that's something we also want to avoid. Is we don't want to, like, the church has icons, pictures of various saints, and what we don't want to do is start worshiping those icons and images. We don't want to treat those as the actual people. Like if you take an icon and you were to rip an icon, a lot of those people would think that you just sinned against that. You did a major blasphemy, but it's not really a blasphemy because it's just a picture. It might be wrong to destroy someone else's property, but that's not yours, that you don't have the authority to destroy. Perhaps not. But it's not the horrible blasphemy that a lot of people will say to destroy. What translation are you using there? Because it's always important to look at the translation. I think you have to be careful, as I said. But, you know, if you feel like all pictures are not okay, then I would hope that you would follow through with that for your life and not have the pictures. That's good. It's, you got to base it on your conviction. Let me say this. When God tells us to do certain things, like as Anne said earlier, that was the things that I mentioned were commanded by God. But you have to remember, would he command us things that are stumbling blocks or things which are detrimental to us? So the idea is, why would he command people to make images if he knew that they were going to fall into idolatry for it? Because what happened, remember when he commanded Moses to make that bronze serpent, later on they started worshiping that and sinning. And so why would God make that if when he knew that it was going to lead to, you know, it was going to lead to people doing idolatry? This, so to me, when God is commanding us to make images, it indicates to me that this is probably not a major sin that people are saying we're to have no pictures at all, to have no pictures, because if it was, then every time he commands you to have a picture, that's that much more likely that you're going to think it's okay to do. So why would he try to confuse you and to do something that's in all other cases sinful? That would be a very strange thing for him to do. So I think the very fact that he's commanding us to make images in certain instances suggests that when the law says not to make idols or likenesses, that it's talking about more towards of the worship or honoring right, they started worshiping things after, so the bronze serpent that Moses made, they weren't worshiping it at the beginning, but later on, down the road, in the time of the judges, they started worshiping the idol. So, hopefully that gives a good explanation. We can, in future studies, if you're still not convinced about that issue, we can revisit it and even look at the Hebrew some more. Because as I said, it's really the Hebrew, because when we translate it into these languages, the way we translate it can be very deceptive. And we can make a lot of doctrines off of a bad translation. And I think there's a lot of bad translations out there. So we want to be careful not to jump to conclusions based on English translations. We want to be careful. And if something doesn't make sense, then we shouldn't go to it. Like, as I said earlier, the computer has images. So if all pictures are wrong, then I don't think you guys should be using the computer. Or you shouldn't be using a TV. I try not to use a TV anyway, for other reasons. Yeah, and the smiley is a graven image. Yeah. I don't watch TV, but you know, there are some people, like, a computer is essentially the same thing as a TV. It's just used, they designed it to be different mediums, but you could use a TV as a computer. People do that. You can use a computer as a TV. And so the basic idea is, if we are to be consistent with the position of no pictures, then I really think that we should not be using the computer at all. So that we wouldn't be able to do these studies right now. So if you guys truly believe that there's no pictures tolerated at all and that it's idolatry, then I think to be consistent, you'd have to not be using the computer anymore. And hopefully that doesn't have to be the case. But if that's what God really wants us to do, then we should try to follow through with that. But in my understanding, the idolatry thing is not about that. It's about, in the context of the Law of Moses, it's talking about worshiping. Because you see, do not have any other gods before me. Do not make idols or likenesses. But the context is talking about worship. So we always want to also look at the context too. So I don't think what we're doing right now, you're seeing a picture of me. Yeah, sometimes she can't stay the whole time. Maybe she left because she was uninterested, or maybe she just left because she was unable to stay. She had other things to attend to. But so the image of the video we have right now, I don't think that's idolatry. I don't think that is you guys worshiping me. That's just communicate. We're just communicating. So I don't see how communicating or relaying information. A lot of pictures are information. You could argue that letters, when you're writing words and letters are pictures in a sense. A lot, like there's some languages which are pictographic. Some people say the Hebrew language is pictographic. Well, you know, if the letters of the words we are writing are pictures, that's another issue of it seems to not make sense. Okay, Anne, good to have you back. Basically, the one thing I said while you were gone, that the main important thing that I said was context is important, and it seems to me that the context of the law of Moses, the Ten Commandments anyway, like right before it said, do not have any other gods before me. And then it goes talking about do not make a graven image and have any likenesses. And it seems to me by that context that it's talking about a worship emphasis. And as I was saying to them, even though the computer right now has a image, it's not an image of worship, it's an image of communication. We are communicating through this image, and there's many other images which are used primarily for communicating information to us, and not purposes of like honoring or worshiping it. So hopefully that kind of helps to support the idea that there can be some pictures as long as it's not being used for a worship or honoring, revering purpose, but more towards a communicating purpose. Just like as I was saying, in the Hebrew language, we write the images of the letters. That's just to communicate. It's not to like have a special honor for the images. One person said is there's a difference between using decorations, being creative, and making something and setting it up as an object of adoration. And that's the key, adoration or reverence. You're adoring, revering an image. That's something we want to not do. But when you have pictures or images which you're not adoring, you're not revering, but you're using it for righteous purposes, like, as I said, communication, art, creative, as they said, that to me is something that's acceptable. But as I said, we can look at the Hebrew in a future study if we want to look at it, the issue again, and we can try to look at what it actually says to make sure we're in the right. So if you guys want, I can continue from the what I was going through. But let's see, so far we've been doing this for an hour and 20 minutes. If any of you have to go now or sometime soon, you can feel free. And this is being recorded too, so if you have to leave, you can listen to the rest. Some more questions about the idolatry focus. A Christmas tree, and it seems like you mean a statue. I assume you mean a statue. Let me just say one thing that's kind of funny. There's also something called a Hanukkah bush. I just heard about that recently. A Hanukkah bush. It's kind of like copying the whole Christmas tree thing. It seems to me that the Christmas tree idea is not something that's okay to do. I wouldn't, though, say that these people deserve to die or that they're doing... I wouldn't necessarily say they're doing idolatry, but I think they're sinning when they do the Christmas tree stuff. But it's kind of like... they're not actually worshiping... They're not actually worshiping these gods. And they're not... They don't understand what they're doing. They're not aware of the... Most of the time, they're not aware of the connection with some of the pagan stuff. So I think you have to take that into consideration. But I don't agree with the Christmas tree stuff, because even if... Let's say... Even if it was okay, as some people say it is, even if it was, it's so similar to what the pagans did that I just want to be safe. I'm going to stay away from that. But in my personal belief, it's wrong to do. Jeremiah says something very similar to what Christmas trees are doing, and that what the practice of having Christmas trees is. In Jeremiah chapter 10, we see a description very similar. It says, don't, you know, the Gentiles have their ways of going out, getting a tree, hanging it up, putting decorations on it. And it's kind of like, well, yeah, they were doing that for worship purposes, and these people are not. But at the same time, just because the people are not worshiping the or doing the pagan worship, they still shouldn't be doing the Christmas tree stuff, because it's adoring and honoring the pagan rituals from the past. Or even if it wasn't pagan, as some might say, even if it wasn't pagan, it's a completely vain thing. It's a vain thing. So there seems to be a lot of reasons not to do it. Yeah, and there's a lot of justifications of what people do. It seems to me, it just makes more sense. If you want to give gifts to people, give gifts to people. You don't need a tree to do that. You don't need to put decorations on it. And all the Santa Claus stuff and the reindeer stuff is silly. Even if it wasn't pagan, it's just silly stuff, and it's a waste of time. And it takes your focus off the things that are really important. And it also encourages a very materialistic spirit, and one that's not focused on loving others as yourself. Yeah, when some people say, you know, Merry Christmas or things like that, there's an issue of how do people respond to that. And some people try to take the approach as to what John said of, like, you know, saying kind of like, almost like a snappy comeback of, you know, but I sometimes feel like I will say something of, I either won't say anything, just kind of smile, or just say like, thanks for your wishes or something like that. You know, it's basically, but I don't say Merry Christmas back. You know, you don't, if you don't think it's okay to do, you shouldn't say Merry Christmas when, you know, but I try not to be snobbish, or, you know, make people think I'm arrogant. And so without people being given a context, I don't want to appear cold to them either. So I think there's ways of approaching people. You want to make sure you approach people right about the issue. But yeah, I think the Christmas tree stuff is related to the whole issue of idolatry, and making images. And so, and a statue. Well, as I said, Solomon and Moses made statues. I guess the purpose of the statue would be the question. And again, it's, as we said, the adoration issue. There are people who adore the statues. That's off. You know, that's not right. But if you were to make a statue for some other purpose, a memorial of something important that happened, I think there's a memorial of, there was one memorial of somewhere in like the line of the North-South. I think they made like a statues of two men making an agreement, a pact, like the Mason-Dixon line. I think there was like an agreement that was made, and they memorialized that by having the images of two men like shaking hands and making the covenant. So things like that seem to be not so bad. But if you make a statue, for instance, of your favorite celebrity, or statue of just because you love them so much, and, you know, and like someone who's obsessed about the celebrity, you have a statue of that actor or actress, and like you're like, oh, you know, that seems to me to be something that's not okay to do. That would be an instance of going too far, and you're having a statue for the wrong reasons. I'll say a little more about I'm gonna go back to what I was reading, going through earlier, of the history. I don't know how much of this I'll be able to go through, but I'll go through a little bit more of this. So, let's see here. Abraham's descendants were commanded to only marry those who converted to the religion of Noah. And that's why Abraham's descendants married the descendants of Abraham's relatives. Because remember, as I said earlier, Abraham converted his family, like Terah, Nahor, and then their children. So they intermarried with each other because they were of the same basic faith. That's why Isaac married Rebekah, because they were within the same faith, and why Jacob went to Laban and married his daughters, because they were in the same faith. And so Isaac had a son whose name was Jacob. And Jacob was chosen by God to be the father of his holy nation. He made a covenant with Jacob, and he begot the 12 sons. And you know the 12 sons' names. And then Jacob's name was changed to Israel, and the covenant of Israel began. And yeah, as I said earlier, Laura, the difference between demons and evil spirits is demons are... the spirits of the Nephilim who died. So they're basically evil spirits which have no bodies. But they still have a form. Hard to understand, but they sort of have a body, but they sort of don't have a body. So they're in like an in-between where they don't have a full body. Whereas evil spirits, there can be angels who still have bodies. They're not dead. They're alive. But the demons, they're dead. They're dead. So that's the difference. Now, and then the scriptures tell us in the scrolls that Levi, because of his zeal for executing righteousness and true vengeance on the wicked, he was chosen to be the first high priest in a special line of priests. This was the origination of the Levitical priesthood, and it was sealed as a covenant between Levi and God. So, basically, there are some people who say that the Levitical priesthood, that came after the golden calf, that came in Moses' time, the Levitical laws. But in reality, according to the scrolls, the Levitical laws came before, it came with Levi, and it was always the case, that was always the way it was supposed to be done. And that's a very important thing, because it refutes some of these false teachings that are spreading. One of the false teachers out there is Torah to the Tribes ministry. I don't know if you guys are familiar with their teachings, but their main teaching is that most of the law of Moses was given as a negative thing, as a punishment because of the golden calf incident, and that these things are no longer valid anymore, and they are, and that they did not exist before Moses, and they did not exist before the golden calf. But the Dead Sea Scroll faith proves that that's false, and proves that the Levitical laws, the festivals, a lot of the Levitical laws that this guy from the Torah to the Tribes says came after, we see the proof that it came before. And that it was always his intention. He didn't do it as a punishment, but that was always his perfect plan, to have the Levitical priesthood. And so then so there were so many reforms that were introduced by Jacob and his family. So it changed their faith a lot. And then now in the year 1647 BC, Israel, or Jacob, that was the year he died, and he wrote tablets recording the events of his own life, and then when he finished them, he handed over those tablets to Levi, his son, and he handed all the tablets of the forefathers to Levi, the priest, high priest. And then all of Jacob's sons, his 12 sons, they also wrote tablets of their own when they were near death about their lives and prophecies and teachings for their children. And these were found on the Dead Sea Scrolls. And Levi collected all those tablets. And then Levi's son, Kohath, in Exodus, we're told Levi's son was Kohath. Kohath became high priest in Levi's place and received from Levi all the tablets of the forefathers and the patriarchs. And during this time, after Levi died, the people of Israel were kidnapped by the Egyptians and enslaved in the land of Egypt. And during this time, the people of Israel were corrupted by the religion of Egypt, and so there was heretical offshoots of their Israelite religion. Near the end of Kohath's life, Kohath wrote tablets recording the events of his own life. A copy of this was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, a copy of Kohath's own writing that he wrote for us, the Testament of Kohath. And there's prophecies in there and teachings to his son, and Kohath tells us that he was giving the writings of his forefathers to his son Amram. The book of Exodus tells us that Amram was the father of Moses and Aaron. Jubilees also says the same thing. And so Amram became high priest in Kohath's place and received the tablets. And then around 1485 BC, Amram, near the end of his life, this was at the end of his life, Amram wrote tablets recording the events of his own life. And he called his two sons to him, Aaron and Malachiah. And he blessed his sons. Aaron was made high priest in the place of Amram, and Aaron received all the tablets of Amram. This copy, the Amram's writing, was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Several copies of it were found, and he writes about his children and his family and his life. There's some amazing stuff in there. And he speaks about the names of his son, and one of his sons' name is Aaron, and the other son he had was named Malachiah. And this was actually Moses' original name, according to these scrolls. Moses' original name was Malachiah. And it basically means messenger. It might be messenger of Yah, or it might be just messenger something else. So, but messenger. And so, or in other words, an angel. To reveal the truth to the people, to relay the message. And so, but Moses was given a name, he was given the name of Moses by his Egyptian foster mother. So, for the first 3 months, Exodus tells us Moses was born, and for 3 months he did not have the name of Moses. Only after 3 months was he found by the woman, the Egyptian woman, and was named Moses. So the question is, what was his name during the first 3 months? And that's answered by the scrolls. His name was Malachiah. And so God chose Moses to be the one who would save Israel. And Moses was an extremely righteous man, and I also believe that he was the only one in his time who had never sinned in his entire lifetime. And in 1425 BC, Moses led the people of Israel out of Egypt into the promised land that belonged to them. And in this year, God appeared to Moses on Mount Sinai, and Moses took the tablets of his forefathers from Aaron, and an angel appeared and helped Moses on Mount Sinai, helped him study the tablets of his forefathers. And during 40 days, the 40 days he was on Sinai, and as Exodus mentions, during those days, the angel explained to him the meaning of all the tablets of his forefathers, Enoch, Noah, all those. He explained to them the meaning, and he gave him laws. The New Testament tells us that Moses was given the law through angels. Nowhere does it say that in our Old Testament, but it says it in Jubilees, and Jubilees claims to be the law by the angels. Jubilees claims to be written by the angels themselves to Moses. And so this, to me, is a clear connection with the New Testament. And so Moses wrote the words of the angel on tablets. These tablets were the book of Jubilees. The Ten Commandments were also given to Moses at the same time, and God wrote those Ten Commandments on two tablets. Now, during the period of 40 years of wandering in the desert, which Israel was required to undergo as a punishment for their sins, Moses received laws from God and taught the people of Israel those laws, and he wrote down the laws he received on tablets. Now, he took the tablets of his forefathers, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Jacob, Joseph, took those tablets and wrote tablets recording an account of the history of Israel from the time of Adam to the time of the enslavement of Israel in the land of Egypt. In other words, he wrote the book of Genesis. After he wrote tablets recording an account of Israel's enslavement in Egypt and how they left Egypt, and tablets recording an account of the law that was given to Moses on Mount Sinai. And he also received laws for holiness on Mount Sinai, and he wrote an account of that. That's Leviticus. So the account of the law on Mount Sinai earlier, that was Exodus. But now this was Leviticus, the laws for holiness. And then he also wrote an account of the events that occurred during the 40 years of wandering in the desert. That's the book of Numbers. And okay, yeah, there John mentions about Moses murdering an Egyptian. And the thing is, it never says he was murdering. The way that the text presents it makes it sound like to people that he's murdering. But that's not the case. Basically, it says that he looked both ways first, and then he killed the guy. It makes it look like, you know, he didn't want to be seen doing the sin. But how the proper way of understanding it based on the New Testament and these other writings is Moses saw that this man was being attacked, and this man was about to perhaps even die, and Moses defended this guy's life, saving as Melissa said, saving someone else's life, and then he fled. Now, if he had just murdered someone and then ran away, that would be a very cowardly thing to do, a very cowardly thing to do. But according to the writer of Hebrews in the New Testament, what Moses did was an act of faith. He was being faithful. Which suggests that the writer of Hebrews agreed with the idea that I just said, and that he did not murder him. Because if he had murdered him, running away would have been faithless. But Hebrews says that Moses ran away in faith because Egypt, the Pharaoh wanted to kill him. And he ran away in faith. And then the Apostle Peter, there's a writing from the Apostle Peter, and Peter tells us that he does not believe that Moses was a murderer, and that's a falsehood that scribes have inserted into Scripture. And basically, the idea is there can be mistranslations. You know, for instance, the Ten Commandments. Some translations say, do not murder. Other translations say, do not kill. So similarly, some translations in ancient times would say, Moses killed a guy. Then other translations would say Moses murdered someone. So the key is, there were some false translations going on, according to the Apostle Peter anyway, and Peter said he does not agree with that translation, and that's a falsehood inserted into Scripture. I think there's a lot of other evidence too that he was in the right for it. I mean, for example, the law actually tells us that it's a capital crime to kidnap someone into slavery. And that's what they did for the Israelites. So essentially, the Israelites actually had justification to kill their slave owners. That's one way to look at it, too, is they were in bondage in Israel. The problem is, if everyone tried to kill their slave owners, then the Egyptians would have sent their whole army to kill them, and they probably would have all died. So it was not advisable for everyone to rebel and try to kill their masters. But Moses felt like he was obligated to do that because the guy was going to he was really hurting this guy, and he felt it was the higher obligation to protect this man's life. And so he defended his life from the guy who had no right to be his master in the first place, and that's a capital crime. So he was right in killing the guy, in my perspective. And yeah, Jubilees in the New Testament tells us that he was 40 years old when he killed the Egyptian. Now, also something important to note, in another book that's no longer preserved, but the church fathers had access to it, they tell us that, and the Apostle Jude is actually quoted this book in his letter, the Testament and Assumption of Moses. And in that book, what we're told is that when, after Moses died, his dead body was being debated over by Michael the archangel and Satan. They were debating, and one of Satan's arguments was, Moses is a murderer, therefore I should have right over his body. Hand over his body to me, that I can do with it what I want to do with it. And Michael, however, was defending Moses and trying to refute what Satan was falsely, you know, accusing Moses of. So there's this issue of, was he a murderer, was he not? And that there was that clash between Michael and Satan over the body of Moses. And Jude, as I said, refers to that story and endorses it as the truth. That's in verse 8 and 9 of the letter of Jude. Now, let's see here. Now, when Aaron was about to die, Aaron wrote tablets recording the events of his own life, and he gave all the tablets that he had received from his forefathers. He gave all that to Moses. So, in 1385 BC, God spoke to Moses and gave him a complete and perfect law, which included all the 1,000 plus laws for the temple, priesthood, and the monarchy of Israel. I'll stop there for a second. If you're not familiar with my teachings, I have shown evidence in the past, and I've done major teachings on this before, of the idea that the Book of Deuteronomy, as we have it, is not the original version of the law. It is a shortened version that the scribes made. The original version was Deuteronomy, but it was much longer, and there were many more laws. And this longer law was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. It's called the Temple Scroll by the scholars, and it's a much longer, like twice as long as our copies of Deuteronomy. And so at this time, that is when he received these thousands of laws at the end of Moses' life, in the 40th year. And these were laws for the temple, priesthood, and monarchy of Israel. And so Moses spoke to Israel and reviewed with them everything that happened during their 40-year journey. And he reviewed with them the entire law. All of this he wrote, he recorded it on tablets. And after this, he wrote tablets recording the events of his life for his sons and for Joshua and the Levites. This was the Testament of Moses. He wrote that. And then after he died, so Joshua was an eyewitness of the Moses dying, and then Joshua wrote in tablets everything he saw involving Moses' dead body and Moses' soul. That's the Assumption of Moses book. And again, as I said earlier, that's about how Satan and Michael were debating over his body. Joshua saw all that, and he wrote it down. And so Joshua gathered all the tablets of the forefathers, as well as Moses' tablets, and he gave the tablets to the priests. And so Moses made so many reforms of the religion, of their faith, that basically the faith became the Moses religion, because it was so much a focus on Moses. And as we can see, we can testify, the Jews are so much elevating Moses, because Moses became like the centerpiece of the faith. It wasn't always that. It used to be Enoch. He was the centerpiece. And then Noah was kind of the focus. And then Abraham and Jacob. finally, Moses became the focus now. Moses' religion was the focus of the faith. And so, how much time are we in here? Yeah, we're in about 1 hour and 50 minutes. Do you guys want me to go a little bit farther, or should we end here today? I'm not going to be able to do the whole history of the faith, because there's much more. So I can continue that in the next study. But you want me to go a little bit farther, or is this a good stopping point for you guys? I saw that someone left already. What about you other guys? Laura would like to hear a little bit more, but are you guys up for a little bit more, or are you needing to go? Okay. And what about you, Ian? Are you able to stay, or do you have to go? And Melissa, because if it's only one person, okay. All right. So I'm gonna go a little bit longer. John, as you said, you have to go to the store. I'm only gonna be doing this for like another 10 minutes. So if you want, you can stay for the rest of that, or if you have something that you got to do, you can go, and this is going to be recorded. And I'm also reading from something, and I'm going to have that on my website, so you could read it. If you don't have time to listen to the video, you could read it on my website, and I'll be posting that on my Facebook. But so, if you need to go, you can, but I'll only do this for about 10 more minutes. So then Joshua... he ruled Israel and brought Israel into the Promised Land. Remember, the Promised Land belonged to them. And so Joshua then, he wrote tablets of his life and passed those on to the priesthood. After this time, heretical denominations of the faith of Israel were formed due to mixture of Israel with the surrounding nations. And then God caused righteous judges to raise themselves up to save Israel from their enemies and bring them back to the pure and true religion of Moses. The judges wrote tablets recording the events of their own lives, and then they passed those down to the priests. And after about 300 years of judges, God chose Samuel and made him into a seer. Israel was unhappy with Samuel's rule, and they wanted a king. Samuel complied and gave them Saul as their first king. As we know, that's from 1 Samuel. Afterwards, Saul rebelled against God, and as a result, Samuel chose a new king for Israel named David. God had chosen David because he saw David was a man after his own heart. Now, near Samuel's death, Samuel wrote an account of his own life on scrolls, and he gave the scrolls to the priests. Now, the Old Testament, First Chronicles, or I think it's First Chronicles, maybe Second Chronicles, it tells us that Samuel wrote a book of his prophecy. So that's the evidence. There's evidence that Samuel wrote a book of prophecy that once existed. That's now lost, but at this time we know near the end of Samuel's life, he wrote an account of his life on scrolls, and he gave those scrolls to the priests. And shortly after Samuel died, David was made king. David had as his teachers a seer named Gad and a prophet named Nathan. Now, David was a very righteous king and followed the law perfectly, with the exception of his sins of ignorance and his willful sins against Uriah. That is what 1 Kings chapter 15 tells us. He was perfect and obeyed everything that God had told him, with the exception of his sins against Uriah. And the Dead Sea Scrolls says the same thing. Then, after this, David started a council of the prophets and appointed Nathan as the head of the prophets. Near the end of his life, David had the high priest Zadok transport the Ark of the Covenant, and while this was being done, Zadok discovered in the Ark the tablets of Moses, on which was recorded the complete and perfect law for the temple, priesthood, and the monarchy of Israel. Or, in other words, that temple. The temple scroll, but it was in tablets. And Zadok revealed the tablets to David, And the priests made copies of those temple scrolls and gave copies to David. And so David used the scrolls, the copies that they were made into scrolls, and he used those scrolls to repent of his sins of polygamy and of his other sins of ignorance, because the law that he found explicitly condemned him for what he did in his polygamy and other sins that he did in his lifetime. So when he found that law, he repented and changed his ways. During David's lifetime, David wrote on scrolls 3,600 psalms and 450 odes, for a total of 4,050 songs. That's what the Book of Psalms tells us in the Dead Sea Scrolls. It tells us that's how many he did. Afterwards, David gave Zadok his scrolls. And right before he died, David gave his son Solomon the temple scrolls, and he wrote, David wrote scrolls recording the events of his own life, and he gave these also to Solomon. Then David reformed the religion of Moses a lot, and by adding some new ordinances, and this made the faith heavily Davidic. It was focused on the character of David. In 945 BC, Solomon built the temple according to the laws written in the temple scrolls. During his lifetime, Solomon had as his teachers the prophets Nathan and Ahijah and the seer Iddo. Solomon was blessed with wisdom from God, but because of a woman he fell in love with, he lived most of his life in great sin. That's what actually Solomon tells us himself in his own words in a testament that he wrote. He tells us that the Song of Solomon was written about this woman that he was madly in love with. That led him into sin, great sin. And so during his lifetime, though, Solomon wrote scrolls that recorded all the wisdom he had received in his life. And by the end of his life, he had written 3,000 proverbs and 1,005 songs. And he wrote scrolls recording the events of his life as well. So where does that number come from, 3,000 proverbs and 1,005 songs? That's actually what the Old Testament tells us. In 1 Kings, I think it's chapter 4. I don't remember the exact verse, but it tells us that he did 3,000 proverbs and 1,005 songs. Well, there's only one song of Solomon in the Bible. What happened to the 1,000 other songs? Well, they got lost because of over time, they just got lost because of the laziness of the scribes and the rebellion of the scribes. And so, and then, as I said, he wrote scrolls recording the events of his own life. And Gad, Nathan, and Ahijah also, near the end of their lives, wrote scrolls recording the events of their lives. And that's what the Chronicles tells us. Second Chronicles says that they wrote these scrolls, a prophecy of Gad and Nathan and Ahijah. And so Solomon repented near the end of his life. After Solomon, Israel split into the two nations, the kingdom of Israel and the kingdom of Judah. The righteous living in the kingdom of Israel returned to the kingdom of Judah after the kingdom of Israel had adopted some heretical things. And the kingdom of Judah remained faithful to David's religion. And then sometime after Solomon died, the temple scrolls became lost. And I'll probably end it here with Solomon, basically. So Solomon essentially reformed the religion so much because he added some new things as well. And he made the focus a lot on wisdom. He introduced so much of like wisdom into it, and so it focused on Solomon, the faith of Solomon, and Solomon was the one who built the temple. That changed radically the faith of Israel, having a temple focus. So Solomon was key in changing the dynamic of the entire religion by creating that temple in obedience to the law of Moses. And when Solomon was about to die, he issued a decree that the priesthood was to write official chronicles documenting the history of the nation of Israel. And he gave many laws to the priesthood that he had received from David. So work began immediately, and the priesthood, taking the tablets of Joshua and the Judges, wrote scrolls chronicling the history of Israel during the rule of Joshua and the Judges. So in other words, Joshua and the Judges, they wrote their own books, which we don't have anymore. The priesthood, because of what Solomon commanded them, they wrote new scrolls abbreviating the story of the Joshua and the Judges. And that's the origin of the book of Joshua and the book of Judges. The same thing with the book of Genesis. Genesis is the abbreviated version that Moses wrote using the writings of the patriarchs from time, long time before. And so they also took the scrolls of the seers and the prophets and David and Solomon, and they wrote scrolls chronicling the history of Israel during the rule of Saul, David, and Solomon. Over the course of about 500 years, there were 24 chief prophets who ruled over the council of the prophets. They all wrote their own scrolls recording the events of their lives. The seers also wrote scrolls, and the prophets and seers, as they wrote their scrolls, the priesthood that was obeying Solomon's command to write scrolls chronicling the history of the events of their nations, they took the scrolls of the prophets and incorporated that into their account. So that's where we get 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, and 1st and 2nd Chronicles. Those were all written by the priests in obedience to Solomon's command to record their history. And there was another book that's now lost, which recorded the history of the 10 tribes, the kingdom of Israel. And that's referred to, all of those writings are referred to in the Old Testament. They're referred to and endorsed. They say, for the rest of the information, go to those books. So I'll stop there. Hopefully you guys found that that's that what I shared is very interesting. If there's anything I said which you're unsure about or you question where I got that information, you can ask me. And if you want to listen to the rest of this, as I said, it's recorded. So hope you enjoyed it. Is there any other questions last minute? If there's not, then I'll see you guys hopefully next week at the same time. Looks like there's no questions. All right. I appreciate it so much, and I am really happy to have you guys join me. So shalom to you, and hope to see you next week.